All right, we're going to talk about the difference between precision and accuracy. We use these terms a lot, especially when we're doing lab work, and so we're going to talk about what they mean. Accuracy simply means how close to the true value you are. Often in the laboratory, we are judging you on your accuracy, how close to the true value or the right answer did you get based on your measurements, your calculations, etc. There are times that you don't know what the true value is, in which case you cannot judge your accuracy, but often you do know the true value and you're judged on your accuracy. You indicate your measure of accuracy. Often this is done by doing a percent error calculation. You have information about this in your lab manual, and so you can see how that is calculated. Precision has a couple of different meanings. In the first definition that we're going to look at, it applies when we're talking about, in the laboratory, taking repeated measurements. And if you are taking repeated measurements, precision is a way to indicate how close to each other those repeated measurements are. Let's look at an example comparing and contrasting precision and accuracy from the lab. For example, let's say we have a lab full of students and the students are taking volume measurements. They are recording the volume of an object by water displacement, and they're doing three trials each. So each group of students or each student is doing three trials where they are measuring a volume by water displacement. Okay, let's look at these hypothetical student measurements. For example, student number one measures these three volumes for his three trials. Let me just point out, if your table is labeled with a unit, you do not have to keep writing units on all of your measurements. It is assumed that all of your measurements have this particular unit. The other alternative would be to go ahead and write the unit of milliliters on every single numerical value. So these are the three volume measurements for student number one, trials one, two, and three, 11.3 milliliters, 11.2 milliliters, and 11.4 milliliters. The average, if we calculate an average and round it to three significant figures for this student, the average is 11.3 milliliters. I would not need to write the milliliter unit here because it is in the header of my table. Student number two does three trials, and these are the values that student number two finds. Student number two records 11.8 milliliters for trial one, 11.1 for trial two, and 11.0 for trial three. The average for student number two is still 11.3 milliliters, exactly the same as student number one, but I think you can tell by looking, there's something different about this student's data. The data are not the same as student number one's. Now let's come to student number three and look at what student number three got for the three volume trials. Student number three found 11.8 milliliters for trial one, 11.7 milliliters for trial two and three, making the average, when rounded to three sig figs, 11.7 milliliters. In terms of accuracy and precision, we would say that student one, the data were more precise than student two, and student three's data were also very precise. So we would say that the data here and here were precise. Usually, you have a very good feeling for whether or not something is precise, or else you are comparing two sets of data if you're talking about the precision. And I think you can tell that student number one and student number three had three measurements that were much closer to each other than student number two. Student number two's data has one value that is radically different than the other two data points, comparatively speaking, as we look at examples of other sets. So we would say that student number two's data set was less precise than student one or student three. Now, if we want to comment on the accuracy of the data, we have to know the true value. If we don't know the true value, we can't comment on who has the more accurate data set. Let's say that you are told that the true value is 11.8 milliliters. In that case, you would say that the data set from student number three was more accurate than the data recorded for student 1 and student 2. And so that is a way to distinguish between accuracy and precision in this instance. To look at another way to talk about precision, we want to look at this example of a graduated cylinder. You're going to be using a lot of different types of glassware and equipment in the laboratory, but a lot of the equipment you use will have markings that are very similar to the markings on a graduated cylinder. Another definition of, or another use of the word precision, is in reference to using these graduations to make measurements. For example, let's say this is a graduated cylinder and the markings on this graduated cylinder are like this. As we look, each of the large markings goes up by 5. This could continue on, but we see that each of the big marks are 5 milliliters, and then each of the little marks in between are 1 milliliter each. If we blow up a portion of this graduated cylinder and focus on part of the measurements, what we see here is that the level of liquid in our container in a graduated cylinder would be recorded comparing it to these markings. And so, for example, I have here the marking for 25 milliliters, the marking for 30 milliliters, which means each one of these in between is 1 milliliter, so this would be 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. As you look at the graduated cylinder and look at the liquid in it, there will be a meniscus. And you always want to turn the graduated cylinder so that you see the most bottom portion of the meniscus where the marks are. On this particular example, I'd probably twist it a little bit clockwise so that these markings were further to the left, so that the bottom of the meniscus was clearly evident here, so that this was sort of in the middle of the graduated cylinder. So let's sort of focus in on, here's my graduated cylinder, so my meniscus is going to be down here, and the bottom portion, I'm horrible freehand as you can see, the bottom portion of the meniscus is going to be, I'm going to be able to see it in line with the markings on the graduated cylinder. So here is the bottom level of my meniscus. Sometimes it helps if you hold something behind the graduated cylinder so that you're not distracted, because usually these are glass so you can see through them. You're not distracted by whatever's behind the graduated cylinder. I usually put my hand behind it at the level of the meniscus. You could also put a dark piece of paper, or maybe your calculator, or a light piece of paper. You might want to play around with putting different things behind the graduated cylinder to see what works best for you. So I am going to squat down till I'm at eye level while this is sitting flat on the countertop, and I am going to look at where the bottom of the meniscus is in reference to the markings on the graduated cylinder. So this is what I see, and you'll notice that the bottom of the meniscus is between these two markings on my graduated cylinder. These two markings represent 27 milliliters and 28. And I do this in my head, even to this day, with years of experience. I literally count these markings that my meniscus falls between. Since this is 25 and this one is 30, this is 27 and 28. So my meniscus is between the markings of 27 and 28. So my value for the volume in this graduated cylinder is 28 point something. That something is the one digit that I will estimate in between the markings. The precision of this glassware is such that I can read one decimal place. That's the precision of these markings, because that is my estimation in between the markings. You are literally making an estimation, and so different people might read slightly different values for that estimated digit, but that's the last digit you record, because you are estimating it. So as far as significant figures goes, that's the last digit that gets recorded. You never record more than one uncertain digit in a measurement. You always stop at the first uncertain measurement, the first digit that has some uncertainty, the first digit that's estimated. So I might record that this is 27.4 milliliters for my volume, My partner might say, well, that looks more like 27.5 to me or 27.3 to me. And that's absolutely fine because we are estimating it. However, when you and your partner are both working on the same experiment, you should always record the same estimate value, the same value for your reading, so you're going to have to come to the agreement on it. All right, as we look at this graduated cylinder, we might notice that the markings were different than the previous one we used. For example, we might notice that in this particular graduated cylinder, this was marked as 1. This was marked as 2, this was marked as 3, this was marked as 4. It probably goes to higher than this, but this gives us an example of some markings we might see on a graduated cylinder. Let's get a section blown up for us to use here. All right, in this blow-up section, what you notice is that the markings on this graduated cylinder now represent something different than the ones on the previous graduated cylinder. If this marking represents a 2 and this marking represents a 3, then this is my 2.5, and each one of these is a 0.1. So this would be 2.1, this one would be 2.2, and so on, 2.5, 6, 7, 8, 2.9, and 3. On this particular graduated cylinder, now I'm going to get a different precision for my reading because it records absolutely, based on the markings, a different number of decimal places. In the previous one over here on the left, each of the markings was 1 milliliter, and so my estimation in between was my first decimal place. Each of the markings on this new graduated cylinder are already the first decimal place, so I'm going to estimate in between those markings to a second decimal place. Again, I want to twist the graduated cylinder so that the meniscus, the lowest part of the meniscus, falls within my eyesight of the graduation so that I can see where the lowest part of the meniscus is. And so I will read the bottom of the meniscus. Again, I might want to hold something behind the graduated cylinder, and I will read it exactly between the markings as best I can, but then estimating one more digit. This marking, if this is 2.1, 2.2, 2.3, this marking is 2.3. This marking is 2.4, and again, I even say that out loud. It's between 2.3 and 2.4, therefore it is 2.3x, where I will estimate the second decimal place. My precision is now in the second decimal place, or the hundredths place, rather than the tenths place. And again, I will have to estimate in between the markings. So for example, I might decide that that looks like 2.37 milliliters. And again, my partner might say, well, it looks more like 2.36. That's okay, but we want to come to an agreement to record it in our notebook. And we will stop recording on the digit that we have to estimate. One last thing about this, if you happen to see a volume level that is exactly on a mark, you're going to run into this. For example, the meniscus is exactly on this mark that is, whoops, how about 1.9? Do you see how that's 1.9 here? If this bottom is 1, this is 1.5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So my meniscus appears to be exactly on the 1.9 mark. I'm going to record that in my notebook, not just as 1.9, but as 1.90 milliliters. I will still record my precision to the 100th place. I should not just say 1.9, I should be saying 1.90 because I am estimating that it is exactly on the mark to give me that point, the zero in the last decimal place.